Preface of History of the Norwegian People, Volume 1, by Knut Gjerset. History of the Norwegian People, Volume 1, by Knut Gjerset. Preface. The growing interest in Norwegian language, literature, and culture in this country has created a special need for a history of the Norwegian people in the English language, devoting sufficient attention to the more important phases of the people's life, to show the development of their institutions and culture, their life at home, and their activity and influence abroad. It has been my aim in this work to meet this demand by having constantly in mind what questions an intelligent reader might be expected to ask, and by trying, as far as possible, to answer them. In the Middle Ages, the Scandinavian peoples were potent factors in developing navigation, commerce, municipal life and government, literature and culture in Northern Europe. But nothing has been taken for granted, nor has any theory been advanced beyond what is clearly established by the investigations of the best scholars. The way to the original sources has, therefore, always been pointed out, and these have been used in a conservative spirit. The views of the leading scholars have been followed, and sometimes preference has been purposely given to the more conservative views on points, where there is or might be a difference of opinion. On the whole, I have deemed it advisable to adhere to Snorre Sturluson's healthful principle. It seems better to us that something should be added later than anything should have to be stricken out. The period of the union with Denmark has been treated with some fullness and detail. The preservation of the people's personal freedom amidst general national decay, the germs of a new development distinctly traceable in social life has been especially dwelt upon, not only because these features are characteristic of the life of the Norwegian people in that period, but because they constitute the basis of their political and social development in modern times. Regarding Norway's long struggle for complete independence after 1814, an attempt has been made to state facts fearlessly and impartially, without any spirit of antagonism against the noble and heroic Swedish people, who are and will be Norway's truest friends. In proper names, the original spelling has been preserved, except in a few cases where a distinct English form has been developed, as Copenhagen, Gothenburg, Charles John. The attempt to give Norwegian names an English form, or to translate appellatives, destroys their euphony and character as names, and leads to many difficulties. An aid to the pronunciation of Norwegian names will be found under a separate heading. Knut Gjerset, Luther College, Decorah, Iowa, August 1, 1914. End of preface. Chapter 1 of History of the Norwegian People, Volume 1, by Knut Gjerset. Chapter 1, The Country and Its Resources. The Kingdom of Norway forms a part of the Scandinavian peninsula, embracing its mountainous western slope. It consists of a rock-bound coast region 1,700 miles in length, when measured along the outer belt of rocks. In the southern part, it is about 260 miles wide, in the northern about 60 miles, though the extreme northern province, Finnmarken, is considerably wider. Measured in a straight line, the distance north and south from Vardø to Lindesnes is about 1,100 miles, so that if the country were swung around, its northern extremity would reach the Pyrenees. Norway is a little larger than the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Ireland, its total area being 124,495 square miles, or about the same as that of our New England states together with New York and New Jersey. The country consists of a mountain plateau, broken by two larger depressions, one in the southwestern part, another and smaller one around the Trondheimsfjord. These two tracts, Østlandet and Trøndelagen, consisting of undulating mountain slopes, contain extensive and valuable forests of coniferous trees, and are especially well adapted to farming and cattle raising. The southern coast region, Vestlandet, as well as the northern part, Nordland and Finnmarken, is intersected by narrow fjords extending far into the country. These deep cuts in the rocky plateau continue inland as narrow, fertile valleys, abounding in streams and waterfalls, and are often of incomparable beauty and grandeur. Fringing these valleys are large mountain tracts unfit for agriculture, bearing timber, grass, and wild berries. These tracts are valuable as pasture and timberlands, while an abundance of wild game lends them a special charm as excellent hunting grounds. The high inland plateau is uninhabitable, being for the most part covered by glaciers and perpetual snow. This is the undisputed domain of birds and wild deer, which exist here in such numbers as to render even these large areas of frozen desolation of considerable importance to domestic economy. Norway lies north of the 58th parallel, its southern extremity, Lindesnes, being at 57 degrees, 59 minutes north latitude, while in the north it reaches a latitude of 71 degrees, 11 minutes. If the country were applied to the North American continent in the same latitude, its southern part would be found to lie in the region of central Labrador, while its northern extremity would reach the magnetic pole. Considering its high latitude, the climatic conditions of the country are unique. The Gulf Stream, passing up through the Atlantic to the west of the Scandinavian peninsula, so affects conditions in this respect that nowhere else in the world is the average temperature so high in the same latitude. The climate varies a great deal with the elevation above the sea, as well as with the latitude, but south of the Arctic Circle the average temperature is about the same as in our northern tier of states, being cooler in summer and warmer in winter than in our states, resembling more closely the climate of the state of Washington and British Columbia. Thunderstorms are rare, even in the southern part. The coast is often swept by strong winds or severe storms, especially in winter, but in inland districts the air is almost always calm, owing to the uniform temperature. The winter is long and dark, in the northern part of the country an almost unbroken night. A deep covering of snow then spreads over mountains and woodlands, affording unequaled opportunity for sleighing and skiing, which form the most characteristic features of winter life in Norway. The summer, with its almost continuous daylight, is very beautiful. From the last days of May till the end of July, the sun never sets on northern Norway, and even in Christiania days fade so gently into night that they can scarcely be told apart. The summer landscape of fjords and wooded mountainsides, dark headlands and green islands, which break the evening sunlight into various hues and tints, has the ethereal mystic beauty peculiar to high latitudes. Fishing, farming, and cattle raising were the chief occupations from early times, and they still continue to be the people's principal means of subsistence, though many new pursuits, such as lumbering, commerce, and manufacturing, have become of great importance in later years. According to the sagas, splendidly painted ships with many colored sails carried fish from Norway to England over 1,000 years ago, and fish still continues to be one of the chief articles of export. Especially important are the herring and cod fisheries, though mackerel, halibut, salmon, sea trout, sardines, and lobster are also caught in large quantities. The most noted fishing grounds are the Lofoten Islands, where 36 fishing stations are located. In the early months of winter, about 40,000 fishermen gather here to take part in the cod fisheries. The average value of the yearly catch of herring, cod, and other varieties of fish, when ready for the market, is estimated at $12 million. Agriculture is one of the leading pursuits in Norway, and is carried on in all parts except in the extreme northern region north of the 70th parallel, where no grain can be raised. Scarcely 3% of the total area of the country is under cultivation, and of this area the greater portion is meadow, only 0.7% of the total area being devoted to the cultivation of grain. But although the acreage is small, a remarkably large number of people devote themselves to farming. According to the census of 1900, 993,000 persons, or 44.7% of the population, were connected directly or indirectly with this occupation. The average yearly value of agricultural products in the period from 1895 till 1900 was $17,496,000. Of the cereals, wheat, barley, oats, and rye are raised. Wheat and barley were cultivated on the Scandinavian peninsula as early as in the Younger Stone Age, prior to 1500 BC. Oats was introduced in the Bronze Age, 1500 to 500 BC, and rye in the Iron Age, after 500 BC. Oats is the chief grain in most districts, being cultivated more extensively than any other cereal. The average annual yield is 9,500,000 bushels. Barley, which ripens as far north as 70 degrees north latitude, yields annually about 4 million bushels. The wheat growing area is small, being restricted chiefly to the southern district. The yield is about 255 bushels annually. Rye is the chief food grain in Norway, and ripens up to 69 degrees or 70 degrees north latitude. But it is not raised extensively, as spring rye gives a small yield, and the winter rye is not reliable. The annual yield is about 900,000 bushels. A considerable area is devoted to the raising of peas and potatoes. The peas crop is 220,000 bushels. The potato crop is about 23 million bushels annually. Fruit raising is carried on in many parts of Norway, but not on a very extensive scale. Apples, pears, and cherries are raised, and berries, such as currants, gooseberries, and raspberries, are grown in great abundance. Of wild varieties, the blueberry, cloudberry, and whortleberry are found in inexhaustible quantities in the mountain districts. The home market is often glutted with these delicacies at certain seasons of the year, and the export of berries is a growing source of income. The raising of cattle and other domestic animals is of even greater importance than agriculture, because this branch of husbandry can be carried on with success in places where grain cannot be cultivated. During the last few years, the income from this source has been about $40,500,000 a year, or more than the income from fishing and agriculture combined. In connection with cattle raising, dairying has, especially of late years, become of great importance, and may almost be said to be a new branch of husbandry. It has been greatly stimulated through the organization of cooperative dairies with scientific methods of butter making, and by the building of cheese factories and milk condensing stations. In the period from 1885 till 1900, the number of dairies increased from 249 to 650. In olden times, wild game was so plentiful in the mountain regions of Norway that hunting was an occupation of considerable importance. The Anglo-Norman historian, Ordericus Vitalis, who visited Norway in the first part of the 12th century, writes, "Rural homesteads are found in large numbers around the lakes of the interior. The people have plenty of fish, fowl, and meat of wild animals. They keep strictly the commandments and strict laws of the Christian faith, and punish severely any violation of these. From all quarters their ships bring treasures into the country. Hunting has lost its former significance, being now carried on mainly as a sport, but wild game is still very plentiful in all parts of the country, and a considerable income is derived from this source in many districts. The red deer, the elk, and the reindeer still inhabit the mountains and forests in large numbers. The total of 2,033 head killed in 1897 may be regarded as a fair yearly average. Still greater are the number and varieties of birds and small game. The grouse is, no doubt, the most important wild game in the country. So plentiful is it that about 2 million birds are shot or snared every year. The coast of Norway is yearly visited by hosts of wild geese, swans, eider ducks, and other aquatic fowl, and great quantities of eggs and down are gathered. Commerce reached a high development in Norway in very early times. Through the Viking expeditions, new trade routes were developed, and the Norsemen soon became clever merchants as well as able seamen, and bold warriors." In The King's Mirror, Kongespeilet, Speculum Regulae, written in Norway about 1250, a father gives advice to his son, who wishes to become a merchant. "Both knowledge and experience is necessary," says the father, "as a merchant must travel in distant lands and among strange peoples. He should be courteous, pleasing in manners, generous, a good judge of goods, and honest and upright in all his dealings. He should avoid gambling in bad company, and whatever might create the impression that he is a mere barterer and an uncultured person. He should set a good table, dress well, and seek the company of the best people wherever he comes. Study carefully all laws," says the father, "but if you want to be a merchant, there is no law which you should study more carefully than the bjarkeyjarreter, or laws of trade. Though I have been more a king's man than a merchant," he says, "yet I find no fault because you choose this occupation, for it is now chosen by many of our best men." Norway's shipping and commerce are, however, at present, of far greater economic importance than at any earlier period. In 1913, her merchant marine consisted of 2,133 steamships, 1,040 sailing vessels, and 205 motorboats, representing altogether a capacity of 2,586,030 tons. Only Great Britain, Germany, and the United States have a larger merchant marine than Norway. The greater number of this large fleet of vessels are engaged in the carrying trade in different parts of the globe. The earned profits of this trade for the year 1900 were $38,853,000. The forests of Norway are very extensive, covering about 24% of the entire area of the country. About three-fourths of this area is covered with coniferous, and one-fourth with deciduous trees. The value of the annual export of timber and other forest products is estimated at about $15,740,000. Mining has not hitherto been engaged in on any extensive scale. The most important mines are the Kongsberg silver mines, which have been worked since 1624, the Røros copper mines, operated since 1646, and the Sulitjelma copper mines, which were opened in 1887. Iron ores occur in large quantities in many places, and the mining of this metal is rapidly increasing. Manufacturing is of comparatively recent development in Norway. In olden times, manufactured articles were either imported, or they were supplied through private industry carried on in the homes by members of the family or by skilled laborers. A high degree of skill and artistic taste had been developed in the many handicrafts long before the times of recorded history. Weaving of homespun cloth, both of wool and linen, was common, and the farmers made their own tools and implements. It was the pride of the women then, as it is still in Norway, to embroider with taste, and there were artisans skilled in blacksmithing, wood carving, and in the making of ornaments of precious metals. Shipbuilding and the making of weapons were national arts which were held in high esteem, and were carried on with surprising skill in design and workmanship. With the development of towns and cities in the 11th and 12th centuries, and through the influx of skilled foreign artisans in the 13th, 14th, and 15th, a system of crafts and guilds originated which gained full control of the different lines of manufacture. This system of corporations produced a new industrial growth. Each guild had a monopoly on its specialty, to which the members were limited by strict laws, and which they did much to develop. The old native artisans, not able to compete with these new organizations, lost their importance and also much of their former skill. But to some degree they have survived all industrial changes, so that even at the present time workers in wood, silver, and brass can be found here and there in the rural districts, whose art seems to have been inherited through successive generations from those early times. The development of manufactures is limited chiefly to the 19th century, the growing having been especially rapid during the last 60 years. In 1850, only 12,700 persons were employed in the factories of Norway. In 1900, the number had risen to 70,000. With the cheap and almost unlimited water power available, and with a rich supply of minerals and other raw materials, manufacturing seems destined to become the great future occupation of the Norwegian people. But hitherto, during all the centuries of the past, the location, as well as the general character of the country, has been favorable to the development of the seafaring life along the extensive coasts, and the husbandry in the inland districts which have given Norwegian national life its distinctive features, both economically and socially.
End of chapter 1.
Chapter 2 of History of the Norwegian People, Volume 1, by Knut Gjerset. Chapter 2. Scandinavia in Prehistoric Times. How long Scandinavia has been inhabited cannot be determined. When history, about 800 AD, first lifts the veil of darkness which envelops the remote past, we find a people far advanced in civilization, possessing a high social organization, art, laws, and even some degree of luxury and refinement. No detailed account can be given of the people's life and development prior to this period, but archaeology has been able, through numerous finds of relics of antiquity, to establish some important data regarding prehistoric conditions which make it possible to trace in large outlines the greater phases of progress and the mode of life. Iron has been in use in Scandinavia since about 500 BC, and the period from 500 BC to 1500 AD is called by archaeologists the Iron Age. Other metals were in use earlier. Articles of gold, copper, and bronze were brought to Scandinavia from southern Europe as early as 2000 BC. About 1500 BC, bronze seems to have come into general use in the making of weapons and edged tools. The period from 2000 BC to 500 BC, when iron makes its appearance, is therefore known as the Bronze Age. Prior to this era, weapons and implements were made of stone, wood, bone, and horn, and this earliest period is called the Stone Age. In this period, two different epochs were noticeable, the Older Stone Age and the Younger Stone Age. In the Older Stone Age, people seem to have lived almost exclusively by hunting and fishing. Their clothes were made of skin, their tools and weapons of horn and bone. They had only one domestic animal, the dog, probably a domesticated jackal. No graves have been found from this period. The most important remains are the great shell heaps, Alfaldsdinger, Kirkenmerdinger. These heaps consist of mussel and oyster shells, and of bones of fish, birds, and animals, such as the bear, urochs, wild boar, deer, wolf, fox, etc., embedded in which are found arrowheads, spear points, and other stone weapons and implements, together with fragments of earthenware and articles made of bone and horn. The Younger Stone Age gives evidence that great progress had been made in many ways. Stone weapons and tools were made, as a rule, of flint, which was the best-known material for edged tools. They are nicely polished and graceful in form, bearing evidence of the taste and skill of the makers. Agriculture may be said to have begun, since both wheat and barley are known to have been cultivated. Nearly all the domestic animals were introduced, which can be seen from bones found in the graves from this period. The importance of flint from Denmark to the Scandinavian peninsula, of which there is evidence, seems to show that navigation, too, was in the process of development. Of special importance to the study of the Younger Stone Age are the many graves preserved from this epoch, a great number being found especially in southern Sweden. In Norway, they are found in the southeastern part. They may be divided into three groups, the dolmens, the passage or gallery graves, and the stone coffins. The dolmen consists of stone slabs reaching from the bottom of the grave to some distance above the ground, so placed as to form a circle, and a great stone slab is placed on top as a roof. The bottom of the grave is made of sand or gravel. These graves are made for a single body, which was usually buried in a sitting posture. The gallery graves are constructed very much in the same way, but they are burial chambers of considerable size, supplied with an entrance passage. They are sometimes 20 feet long, 12 feet wide, and 6 feet high. The stone coffins consist of stone slabs placed on edge, with other slabs placed over them for a cover. The custom of constructing such permanent abodes for the dead rests, no doubt, on the belief that the spirits of the departed continue to exist after death, much in the same way as in this present life. The grave was to be a suitable habitation, supplied with such necessaries as they might need. Clothes, weapons, ornaments, even food and drink were placed in the grave with the dead body, and offerings, probably connected with the worship of the spirit of ancestors so common among early peoples, were, no doubt, performed on the flat stone forming the roof of the grave. End of chapter 2. Chapter 3 of History of the Norwegian People, Volume 1, by Knut Gjerset. Chapter 3, The Bronze Age. The introduction of bronze, and the livelier intercourse with other countries, of which there is a proof, gave rise to a new culture in the Scandinavian North, much higher than that which the Stone Age had produced. Weapons, ornaments, vessels, and utensils were now made with a taste in design and ornamentation sometimes worthy of the skilled artisans of Rome itself. Most of these articles were made at home, but the bronze had to be imported from the British Isles and the countries of Central and Southern Europe. This shows that ships of considerable size must have been built, and that the peoples of the North were able to navigate the sea, though they had not yet learned to use sails, which were first introduced in the Iron Age. This can be seen also from the rock tracings of this period. These strange records of the past are pictures chiseled on the flat surface of rocks, sometimes also on stone slabs in the graves, illustrating many phases of life. Among the many things represented in these pictures are boats, carrying sometimes as many as 30 men, but there is no indication of mast or sail. Horses can be seen drawing two-wheeled carts, spans of oxen hitched to four-wheeled wagons, farmers engaged in plowing, warriors on horseback, etc. The full meaning of this system of picture writing has not been deciphered, but the pictures themselves throw considerable light on the life of this early period, and they are especially interesting as the earliest written records of the past in the North. Besides bronze, ornaments of gold and many other articles were imported. Many of these articles of foreign make show that the Scandinavian countries already at this time must have been in communication with Southern Europe. The earliest routes of intercourse seem to have followed the large rivers of southern Russia from the Black Sea into Poland, and thence along the Vistula to the shores of the Baltic Sea. The mode of burial was also changed. During the first centuries of this era, the bodies of the dead, together with weapons and ornaments, were placed in coffins made of hollowed oak logs which were deposited in mounds. To this mode of burial we owe the fortunate circumstance that garments have been found in so remarkable a state of preservation that not only the material but also the style can be determined. The garments found are made of woolen cloth, in one instance of linen. The women wore cap, waist, and skirt very much of the same style as they still wear them in our time. The men's dress, besides cap and footwear, consisted chiefly of a cloak-shaped garment fastened about the waist with a belt. No trousers were yet worn. It became customary quite early in the Bronze Age to burn the bodies of the dead, a custom which also marks a great change in the ideas regarding the life hereafter. It is believed that the body was burned in order that the soul might the more quickly be liberated from the fetters of the natural world, and begin in its own separate existence. But the graves still contained weapons, ornaments, and other articles needed by the departed, which shows that though the body was burned, the spirit was thought to continue its existence after death. Women were buried with the same elaborate care as the men, which indicates that already in this early period they were held in high esteem in Scandinavia, and that their position in society was one of dignity and honor. End of chapter 3. Chapter 4 of History of the Norwegian People, Volume 1 by Knut Gjerset. Chapter 4, The Iron Age. About the beginning of the 5th century BC, iron replaced bronze as the most important metal. Throughout the Bronze Age, the people of the north had been in communication with the countries of southern Europe, and through this intercourse they became acquainted with iron, as they had learned to know bronze in the same way at a still earlier period. The Iron Age may be divided into several quite distinct periods. During the pre-Roman period, embracing the earlier centuries of the era from about 500 BC to the birth of Christ, the influence of the Celtic peoples of Gaul and the Alpine region is especially noticeable, but this influence ceased when the Romans, by extending their sway over Gaul and Britain, came into direct contact with the Germanic world. From that time to the fall of the Roman Empire, the superior Latin civilization exerted a preponderating influence on the development and culture in the north. This period has, therefore, been called the Roman Iron Age. The culture which developed under the influence of Roman civilization unfolded itself of a sudden with a certain gaudy splendor produced by the influx of Roman customs and ideas. Richly ornamented swords, coats of ringmail, metal helmets, spurs, elegantly mounted bridles, and rich trappings for war horses give evidence of the splendor of war accoutrements which now came into use. Silver, lead, zinc, and glass were introduced, and money of Roman coinage makes its appearance. A variety of articles for domestic use, such as elegantly designed vases and drinking horns of glass, metal mirrors, bronze statuettes, strainers, silver goblets, bronze vases, razors, shears, tweezers, and costly ornaments of gold and silver, furnish an even stronger proof of the luxury which had been developed in the north long before the Viking Age. The mode of burial remained much the same as it was in the later Bronze Age. The bodies of the dead, together with weapons and ornaments, were usually burned on a funeral pyre, and the ashes and other remains were deposited in bowl-shaped graves, over which sometimes a mound was thrown up, on which a runestone was placed, bearing the name of the dead. The swords and other articles found in these graves have been damaged by fire. Often they have been purposely bent and twisted so as to be rendered useless. Sometimes the body was not burned, but was buried with weapons and ornaments in grave chambers made of stone slabs. The contact of the north with the Roman world, though not a direct one, exerted great influence. Trade was greatly stimulated, possibly also shipbuilding and navigation. The great number of Roman coins and other articles of Roman make brought to Scandinavia by traders show that a lively intercourse must have been maintained with the provinces of the empire. Shipbuilding reached a high stage of development during this period. In 1863, two boats were unearthed in the Nidum Bog near Sundeved in Schleswig. Together with 106 swords, 552 spear points, 70 shield bosses, coins, toilet articles, and other objects. Among other things, also, a shirt or blouse and a pair of trousers made of woolen cloth were found, which show that trousers were worn at this time. The collection seems to have been deposited by the victors after a battle as a sacrifice to the gods, and is thought to date from about 400 AD. One of the boats is of oak, the other of pine. The oak boat is about 80 feet long and 11 feet wide at the middle. It is made for 14 pairs of oars and is riveted together with iron rivets. It has no mast. The prow and stern are both sharp and of equal height, so that it is difficult to tell which is the rear and which is the front end of the vessel. It is of the same shape as the ships of the Suiones, Swedes, described by Tacitus. The states of the Suiones, Swedes, situated in the ocean itself, are strong in fleets as well as in men and arms. Their ships differ from ours in this respect, that both ends present a front always ready for landing. They do not equip their ships with sails, nor do they join the oars in due order to the sides. The oarage is loose, as on certain river boats, and can be changed from one side to the other as circumstances demand. The most striking evidence of the development of culture during this period is the introduction of the runic alphabet and the art of writing. The older runic alphabet consists of 24 characters divided into three equal groups. The first six characters form the word futhark, which is often used instead of the word alphabet to designate the system of runic letters. The resemblance between the runes and the letters of the Latin alphabet is, in several cases, quite apparent, and the Danish scholar L. F. A. Wimmer advanced the theory, which was for some time everywhere accepted, that the runes have been derived from the Latin alphabet, and that they first came into use in southern Germany. The change in the form of the Latin letters was occasioned by the fact that the runes were carved on wood, or cut in stone or metal, which made the use of the angle and straight line much more convenient than the curve or circle. Later, the Norwegian scholar Sophus Bugge advanced the theory that they originated among the Goths in the region north of the Black Sea, an idea which gained further support through the investigations of the Swedish archaeologist Bernhard Salin. He showed that the runes must have been brought to the north along the old routes of intercourse between the Black Sea and the Baltic, known to have existed even in the Bronze Age, as they first made their appearance in those regions. Professor von Friesen, of Uppsala University, has since shown that the runes have been derived from a system of Greek letters, the so-called cursive or running hand, which was much used in everyday life in the eastern part of the empire. Of the 24 runes in the older runic alphabet, 15 are surely derived from this Greek alphabet, and 5 more are, presumably, traceable to the same source. Only 4 are derived from the Latin alphabet, with which the Goths may have become acquainted in the Latin colony of Dacia, north of the Danube. Runic inscriptions have been found wherever Germanic peoples have dwelt, but they are especially numerous in the Scandinavian countries and in Great Britain. The runic inscriptions on stone are by far the most important, and these are found principally in the Scandinavian countries. 100 inscriptions in the older runic alphabet, from 300 to 700 AD, are found in Denmark, Norway, and Sweden, some of which are of great length. The language is everywhere the same, showing that, as yet, no difference in speech existed in the three countries. Besides Wulfius' Bible translation and a few loanwords in the Finnish and Lapish languages, these earliest runic inscriptions are the oldest remains in the Germanic tongue that have been preserved to us. As a result of the closer contact of the empire with the Germanic peoples of the north, the Romans became better acquainted with this part of the world hitherto so unknown. The enterprising Greek explorer Pytheas from Massilia in southern Gaul made voyages to Britain and northern Europe about 330 BC. On one of these expeditions, he also visited Thule and the Amber Coast. His own accounts of these voyages have been lost, but brief notices are given by the Greek geographer Strabo in his Geographica, and by Plinius the Elder in Historia Naturalis. According to Pytheas, Thule was situated 6 days sailing from Britain and 1 day sailing from the frozen or half-frozen ocean called Mare Cronium. He regards Thule as the most northern country, and relates that summer is a continuous day, and winter a continuous night, there for 6 months. The people live on herse and garden vegetables, as well as on wild fruit and roots. Those who have grain and honey make also a drink from these. When they have cut the grain, they bring it into large houses and thrash it there, because they have no bright sunshine, and thrashing floors in the open would be useless because of excessive rains. Strabo, Libro 4, Chapter 5. That Thule is identical with Norway can scarcely be doubted, but the description given of the people may apply to Britain and the North in general. This was about the only knowledge which the world possessed of Scandinavia prior to the Christian era. In the year 40 or 44 AD, Pomponius Mela, a Roman geographer, wrote a book, De Chorographia, describing the countries of the then-known world, in which he also mentions Scandinavia. This is the first time the name is employed by Roman writers. In that bay which we have called Codanus, Scandinavia is prominent. It is still occupied by the Teutons, and surpasses the other islands in fertility and size. Chorographia 3:54. Plinius the Elder, 23 to 79 AD, also uses the name in his Historia Naturalis. He had served as cavalry officer in the German campaigns, and had visited the shores of the North Sea. He manifests a real interest in Scandinavia, which he believes to be an island, or a group of islands, in the Northern Sea. There the Mount Cervo, itself of great height, and not lower than the Riffaic Mountains, forms a bay with the promontory of the Cimbri. This bay, which is called Codanus, is full of islands, the most noted of which is Scandinavia, of unknown size. Libro 4, 96. There are those who tell of other islands, Scandia, Dumnam, Bergi, Berice, or Narragon, the largest of all, whence one sails to Tyle. 1 day's sailing from Tyle lies the frozen ocean called Cronium by some, Libro 4, 104. The name Scandia is still preserved in Skåne, southern Sweden. Tacitus, in his Germania, written 98 AD, distinguishes between the Suiones and their neighbors the Sitones. Beyond the Suiones lies another ocean, sluggish and almost without motion, which is thought to terminate and encompass the sphere of the earth, since the light of the setting sun continues so bright till it rises that it makes the stars dim. Germania 44-45. In the 2nd century AD, Claudius Ptolemy of Alexandria mentions Scandia and Thule. North of the Orcades lies Thule, of which the western part is in the latitude 63 degrees, longitude 29 degrees. Geographia, Libro 2, Chapter 3. East of the Cambrian Peninsula, the Danish Peninsula, there are four islands called Skandia. Three indeed are small. The middle one is in the latitude 58 degrees, longitude 41 degrees, 30 minutes. The one which is largest and farthest to the east, near the mouth of the river Vistula, is properly called Skandia. Its western part is inhabited by the Chaidanoi, the eastern part by the Fanonai and the Firasoi. The southern part is occupied by the Gaute and the Dociones, the middle part by the Linonoi. Geographia, Libro 2, Chapter 12. These peoples are unknown, except the Gaute or Gotar, here mentioned for the first time as the inhabitants of Scandinavia, and the Chaidanoi or Hainar, the inhabitants of Hedemarken in eastern Norway. Denmark and southern Sweden had up to this time been the most densely populated portions of the north, but throughout the Iron Age the population was growing rapidly, and the remoter parts of Norway and Sweden were cleared and settled. Norway, which had hitherto had the smallest population, made gains during this period which placed her in a more equal footing with the other two northern countries. End of chapter 4. Chapter 5 of History of the Norwegian People, Volume 1, by Knut Gjerset. Chapter 5, The Migrations. From 400 AD, Rome was fighting her last desperate battles with the conquering hosts of Germanic warriors, and like a bleeding gladiator was fast tottering to her fall. The legions were withdrawn from Gaul and Britain for the defense of the Italian peninsula, but this served only to give the untiring victors new vantage ground. The weakened defenses of the frontiers were forced, Gaul and Spain were overrun, Rome was sacked, the empire was crumbling to pieces before the onset of this new race, destined to wrest the scepter of empire from the withering hands of Rome that they might teach the world new lessons. The peoples of Germany were no longer unskilled barbarians unacquainted with culture. Since the days of Emperor Augustus, they had followed the Roman eagles as soldiers of the legions, from the Praetorian Guard in Rome to the remotest provinces of the empire. They now possessed great skill in the art of war. They had great leaders, excellent arms, and an efficient military organization, as they had attained to a high degree of general culture, gained through long periods of development, and finally through direct contact with the Roman world. This accounts for their victory over Rome in this most notable contest for world power. That the warriors from Scandinavia also took part in the expeditions against the Roman Empire can be seen from the great treasures of gold brought to the north during this period. At Turaholm, near Trossa in Sweden, were found in 1774 articles of gold weighing altogether 25 pounds, the actual metal value of which at the present time would be $7,214. So many similar treasures have been found that it is regarded as certain that they are the spoils of warlike expeditions against Rome, or part of the tribute paid the Germanic peoples by the emperors of the last Roman Empire during the 5th century. The first Germanic peoples who crossed the borders of the Roman Empire were the Cimbri and the Teutones. They came from the peninsula of Jutland and appeared in the Roman province of Noricum in 113 BC. Their combined fighting force is said to have numbered 300,000 men, and they repeatedly defeated the Roman armies sent against them. The terror in Rome was so great that the expression terror Cimbricus became proverbial. In 104 BC, Gaius Marius, the hero of the war against Jugurtha, was made consul and general. He took the field with a large and well-disciplined army. In 102, he met the Teutones in southern Gaul and destroyed them in the Battle of Aquae Sextiae. The next year he annihilated the Cimbri, who had penetrated into the Po Valley in Upper Italy. The size of the fighting forces of these great migrating hosts indicates that other tribes must have joined them on their southward march. The Herules, a people who played a conspicuous part in the migrations, came from southern Scandinavia. Jordanus says that they were driven from their homes by the Danes, and Procopius states that when their king died, they sent to their own royal race in Thule for a leader. Very early in the period, they migrated southward into the region north of the Danube, where they founded a kingdom. A part of their force joined the army of Odoacer, and aided him in destroying the West Roman Empire. According to Procopius, their kingdom was destroyed by the Longobards, with whom they were waging war. Some of them sought refuge in the East Roman Empire, and some returned to Scandinavia, taking up their abode near the Gautar, where they seem to have had their original home. The Gautar and the Swedes, Sweer or Sviones, are the first peoples in the Scandinavian north which passed out of mere tribal organization and founded kingdoms of some strength and importance. The Gautar inhabited Götaland, a region around the great lakes Vänern and Vättern in Sweden. The Swedes founded the kingdom of Svitiod, which embraced the tribes and territories farther north, around Lake Mälaren. they gradually enlarged their dominions until all Sweden was united under the rule of their kings. The Swedes were closely related to the Goths, among whom kingship had reached a much higher development than in Western Germany, where the kings were still mere tribal chieftains and leaders of the armed host. Among the Goths, the king was the ruler of his people, a national sovereign who traced his lineage to the gods themselves. This institution of national kingship also obtained among the Swedes, and it is probable that they had adapted it from their Gothic kinsmen. The royal seat and center of the kingdom was Uppsala, the oldest and most famous sanctuary in Sweden. The king served also as priest in the great temple there, and this union of the priestly with the royal office must have tended to strengthen greatly the power and influence of the kings of Uppsala. They were of the Silfing family, a royal race which had ruled in Svitjod long before historic times, and were supposed to be the descendants of the god Frey, who according to tradition had built the temple at Uppsala. The Angles, Saxons, and Utes, who effected the conquest of England, came from the Cymric Peninsula. The Saxons were a German tribe dwelling north of the Elbe in what is now Holstein. Ptolemy says that they lived on the neck of the Cymric Chersonesus. From the 3rd century, they are frequently mentioned by Roman historians as marauders in the North Sea. North of the Saxons, in what is now Schleswig, dwelt the Angles. Their name is still preserved in Angeln, a district in southern Schleswig. They are mentioned by Ptolemy, and Tacitus speaks of them in connection with several other tribes, as worshippers of the goddess Nerthus. King Alfred says that northwest of the Saxons lies the land called Angel, Angeln, and Selende, Sealand, and a part of the Danes. Bede, in his account of the conquest, says, "From the Angles, that is, from the region which is now called Angulus, and which is said to have remained from that day till now depopulated, lying between the boundaries of the Utes and the Saxons, came the East Angles, the Mid Angles, the Mercians, and all the race of Northumbrians who dwelled north of the river Humber. They seem to have inhabited the greater part of Schleswig, possibly also some of the Danish islands. They must have migrated to Britain during the conquest, since Bede states that their country was depopulated from that day. The Utes are a more obscure people. They have given their name to Jutland, the northern part of the Cymric Peninsula, where they are thought to have dwelt as early as 100 AD, though they are not mentioned by Ptolemy. They are believed to be the Oidoses mentioned by Tacitus. To them belonged Hengist and Horsa, the chiefs of the Anglo-Saxon host which invaded Britain. The Angles and Saxons were related Low German tribes, but the Utes seem to have been of Danish origin. The Danes inhabited southern Sweden and the Danish Isles. The first account of them is given by Jordanus, who says that they came from Scandinavia and that they drove away the Herules. Procopius states that a part of the Herules, returning northward to their old homes, came to the ocean, no doubt the Baltic Sea. From there they wandered through the Danish territories, whence they returned to Thule. From about 500, the Danes entered upon a period of remarkable development and greatness. Their kings, the Scholdungs, Sildings, dwelt at Lyre in Sealand, where they built the royal hall Herot, celebrated in the old English poem Beowulf. In 515, their king Hygelac made an expedition against the Hetware near the mouth of the Rhine, where he fell in battle. He is, no doubt, the Chachilaisus mentioned by Gregory of Tours, and the Gesta Regum Francorum, who, on an invasion of the Lower Rhineland, lost his life in a battle against the Frankish prince Theodebert in 515. In 565, the Danes made another similar expedition westward. They fought many hard battles, especially with the Heathobeards dwelling south of the Baltic Sea. These landed on Sealand at one time, and advanced almost to Herat, but they were defeated by King Hrothgar, Roar, and his nephew Hrothulf, Rolf Krake. Rolf Krake became the ideal king and semi-mythical hero of tradition, who is said to have been slain in his royal hall, together with his 12 champions, in a treacherous night attack. The Danes were at this time the most renowned people in the north, though the Swedes rivaled them in warlike achievements as well as in wealth and power. The Swedish kings waged war with the Danes, and made expeditions into Estonia, and other regions east of the Baltic. Their royal family was the oldest in the north, and their kingdom, Svitjod, had risen into prominence before that of the Danes. No such united national kingdom had yet been founded in Norway, as in Sweden and Denmark, but kings ruled here also, and the tribes had formed larger unions in different parts. Jordanus speaks of the Norwegian king Rodulf, who, fleeing from his own country, went to Theoderic the Great in Italy and became his man. Rodulf seems to have ruled over a confederation of tribes in southern Norway. The Old English poem Widsith, and more especially Beowulf, preserves many traces of historic events and of social life in Denmark and southern Scandinavia in the 6th century. The detailed descriptions of arms and customs given in Beowulf, no doubt, reflect quite accurately many features of the life of the chieftains and their followers during the 6th and 7th centuries. Hjorvagar, Hrothgar, and Halga are the sons of Healfdene, of the dynasty of the Scyldings, Skjoldungs. Hrothulf, son of Halga, is the Rolf Krake so famous in Danish tradition. Hrothgar builds the hall Herot at Lyre in Sealand, a feature of the tradition which preserves the memory of the power of the Danish kings at that time. Beowulf, a nephew of King Hygelac, comes with a band of followers to help Hrothgar against the monster Grendel. After the military guards of the coast have permitted him to land, he proceeds to Herot with his companions. They have shields, helmets, and brynies of ringmail, and are in every way well-armed and trained warriors. They are courteously received and are entertained in the most hospitable manner. Then Wealhtheow, the queen, entered, the lady mindful of good manners. Adorned with golden ornaments, she came to greet the guests. She first gave the drinking cup to the king of the Danes, and asked him to partake at their banquet. He gladly took the cup, and accepted the entertainment. She went all about, this high-minded lady from the country of the Helmings, and gave gifts to young and old, till the opportunity came when the ring-adorned queen handed the mead cup to the prince of the Geatsas, and she thanked God that her wish had been fulfilled, that at last she could expect from an earl help out of their difficulties. Beowulf, 608-629. When Beowulf had succeeded in killing Grendel, there was great joy at Heorot, and many came from far and near to see what had happened. When the festivities at the hall were at their height, a skop or skald arose. Everyone became silent and listened to what he might have to say. He sang of Beowulf's journey and every old song which he had heard of Sigemund, and of many an unknown heroic deed. About Volsung's combats and distant journeys, about battles and malice, of which none of the children of men yet knew, save he and Fitela alone. Beowulf, 872-880. Sigemund the Volsung is the father of Siegfried, or Sigurd, the slayer of Fafnir, so well known from the Elder Edda, the Volsungasaga, and the Nibelungenlied, and Fitela the Sinfjotel, Sigurd's half-brother. Then the king himself, the giver of rings, stepped from his queen's apartment, rich in glory, with an excellent band of followers, and the queen walked with him into the festive hall with her train of maids. Beowulf, 920-925. The cultural life of this period must not be judged by 20th century standards. Still, there was among these earlier ancestors of ours not only a very considerable civilization in the externals of life, but intellectual culture and a spirit of refinement were not wanting. They appreciated art and fine manners. They had lofty sentiments and noble virtues, less polished, but probably no less vigorous and constant than those which have graced society in later ages. The migrations checked the peaceful intercourse which the Germanic peoples had hitherto maintained with the Roman Empire, and the necessity of supplying their wants through their own skill and industry, created by this change, made itself more strongly felt. The ideas and cultural elements which had been borrowed from the Romans could now be better assimilated, and the native mind began to put its own impress even on articles of luxury, which were now, to a great extent, produced at home. The gold brastiots of this period bear evidence of this transition from Roman to native industry and art. These are ornaments and amulets of gold made in imitation of Roman coins. Besides the original image of the Roman emperor, they are often ornamented with runes, and sometimes with quite original designs representing Thor driving his goats, or Odin with his horse and ravens. The beautifully decorated helmets, swords, shields, buckles, necklaces, and other articles made by native metal workers show these to have been veritable masters in their art. These articles are made with artistic skill and taste. Some are of pure gold, others of gold-plated bronze or silver with ornaments of filigree and inlaid jewels. Pictures on helmets show the style of dress worn both by men and women in this period. The men wore a coat reaching to the knees and fastened about the waist with a belt. It was edged with fur, it had sleeves, and was ornamented in various ways. Trousers were also worn. The lady wore a dress, sometimes ornamented in front with embroidered bands. She wore shawl and necklace, while her hair seems to have hung loose over the shoulders. Different modes of burial prevailed during this period. The bodies of the dead were sometimes burned, and a mound was, as a rule, thrown up over the charred remains, and a runestone was erected on the mound. Sometimes the body, together with weapons and ornaments, was buried in a carefully constructed grave. Over the grave a mound might be constructed, or stones might be set up around it. The dead, both men and women, were often buried in boats. In 880 a ship was found in a burial mound at Gokstad, near Sandefjord in Norway, the blue clay of the mound having preserved it from decay. The vessel, which is made of oak planks, is 80 feet long and 16 feet wide. It has a mast and 16 pairs of oars. Around the ship was hung a row of shields, colored black and yellow alternatively. A chieftain, no doubt the owner of the vessel, had been buried in it. A burial chamber is constructed in the stern, where the body was placed on a bed furnished with a feather mattress. The grave had been robbed of all ornaments of precious metals, but a complete supply of articles belonging to the outfit of a ship at that time was found. Among these articles were several bedsteads, a sleigh, a bronze kettle, and many kitchen utensils, also the bones of 12 horses, 6 dogs, and some birds, which evidently had been sacrificed at the burial. The ship is supposed to date from about 900. In 1904, another ship was unearthed in a large mound at Oseberg, near Tunsberg in southern Norway. 2 women were buried in it, one of high birth, possibly a queen, the other evidently a maidservant. The ship was packed with goods, both fore and aft. Several bedsteads, a sleigh, a four-wheeled wagon, the queen's shoes, and her trunk containing toilet articles were among the objects found. Most of the articles, as, for example, the sleigh and the wagon, are decorated with wood carvings so exquisitely done that they are real treasures of beauty. The ship, which is now fully restored, is 68 feet long and had been beautifully ornamented. It is more tastefully made than the Gokstad ship, and it is regarded as certain that it is the queen's own pleasure yacht. The find dates from about 800 AD. Together, the articles present a picture of civilization most interesting and impressive. It is quite evident that the districts around the Baltic Sea, and more particularly the Scandinavian countries, possessed a culture superior in many ways to that of any other region of the continent north of the Alps. The population seems to have been denser here than elsewhere. Nowhere else are the graves from early periods so numerous as in this region, and nowhere are the relics of stone, bronze, and other metalwork so tastefully designed or so skillfully made. When Tacitus says of the Estonians that they raise more grain than is otherwise customary among the Germans, it is only another bit of evidence of the superior culture then existing on the shores of the Baltic Sea. End of chapter 5. Chapter 6 of History of the Norwegian People, Volume 1 by Knut Gjerset. Chapter 6, The People. In 1677 to 1698, the Swedish scholar Oluf Rudbeck published a large work, Atlantica S. Mannheim, Vera Jafeti, Sedes et Patria, in which he sought to prove that the Atlantis described by Plato was Sweden, the original home of the descendants of Japhet, i.e. the Europeans. The work was held in high esteem until more scientific methods were introduced in archaeological research. Since then, it has been regarded merely as a literary curiosity. The theory that Scandinavia was the original home of the Indo-European race was again revived by K. Penka, who treated the question in a scientific way in his work Die Herkunft der Arier, 1886. The theory that the Indo-Europeans migrated from India into Europe has of late been discarded by many scholars, who hold that the original home of this family of peoples must be sought in northern Europe. Of recent years, some scholars have come to regard the region of the Baltic Sea as the original home of this race. Noteworthy is the theory advanced by Matthias Much that Europe is the original home of the Indo-Europeans, since in Denmark and the region of the Western Baltic, relics have been found showing every stage of development from the earliest to the latest Stone Age without break or interruption. This continuous development is not found in southern Europe or in Western Asia. The Indo-Europeans raised cattle and tilled the soil in their original home, says Much, and the domestic animals which have been thought to come from Asia are no doubt native to Europe. The attempted solutions of this difficult problem will probably never be much more than more or less plausible conjectures. A similar difficulty confronts us when we ask how long the Scandinavians have lived in the countries which they now inhabit. Archaeology shows a gradual and unbroken development from the Stone Age to later eras, with no interruption to indicate any invasion or sudden immigration of any new people. This would tend to prove that the Scandinavians have dwelt in their present home since the Younger Stone Age. Philology holds, on the other hand, that the peoples now living in the Scandinavian north have migrated into these regions at a much later period. The Norwegians are not a wholly unmixed people, any more than are other European nations of today. A considerable foreign element has immigrated into Norway from various countries, at different periods in historic times, and far back of all history there may have been migrations and a consequent mixing of races about which we know little or nothing. The theory that there have been in Scandinavia since prehistoric times two ethnically distinct elements is as old as the Rigsthula of the Elder Edda, which tells of the Thrall, with his yellow skin and black hair, of the fair-faced and light-haired Carl, or Freeman, and of the Jarl, with light hair, bright cheeks, and eyes like a serpent. This idea of two distinct racial elements in the Norwegian people has been advanced by many leading scholars and anthropologists, notably by O. Rieg, Montelius, Wibling, A. M. Hansen, and O. Almgren. The theory of a migration from the east into Scandinavia was held even earlier by Schoening, Kayser, and P. A. Munch. A. W. Brugger remarks that the older and more commonly accepted form of this theory is not verified by his investigations. What can be shown from archaeological finds, thinks Brugger, is that away back in the Stone Age there were two groups in Scandinavia, ethnically somewhat different. The South Scandinavian group, who at one time must have come from the south, had fixed homes and were engaged in agriculture. The Northern or Arctic group inhabited the northern part of the peninsula and must have come from the east or northeast. They lived by hunting and fishing. From Sweden they penetrated farther to Trøndelagen and spread along the coast of Norway from Jæren to Finnmarken. The South Scandinavian group advanced northward, and the northern group were either absorbed or driven out and ceased to exist as a distinct element. How great the difference was between the two groups, and how far down in time distinct traces of the northern group existed, we do not know. Scientific research has not yet been able to throw full light on these problems, but insofar as it is possible to determine distinct racial traits in modern nations, we are justified in saying that the Scandinavians belong to the Germanic branch of the Indo-European race. Anthropological investigation shows that they have preserved more fully the characteristic Germanic traits than have any other people. Skeletons found in the graves from early periods show them to have been at all times a tall race, and early accounts describe them as blue-eyed with light hair and fair complexion. The song Rigsthula of the Elder Edda says of the lady whom the god Heimdall visits, "Her eyebrows were light, her bosom lighter, her neck whiter than the white snow." Of her son it says, "Light was his hair, bright were his cheeks, and sharp his eyes like the serpent's." These characteristics have been well preserved to the present time. The first extensive anthropological investigation of the Norwegians was made during the American Civil War. They were then found to be the tallest of all Europeans, the Americans and Indians alone surpassing them in height. In chest measurement, they were surpassed by none. For the last 35 years, the Norwegian recruiting statistics give complete data. A great improvement in the physical condition of the recruits is noticeable during this period. The increase in height has been so marked that the Norwegians are now the tallest of all peoples, surpassing even the Americans in this respect. Military statistics show that the emigration of the last 30 or 40 years, which has been thought to be so detrimental to the physical efficiency of the nation, has had the opposite effect. In districts where emigration has been especially heavy, the number of narrow-chested and weak-bodied persons has rapidly decreased, and fewer are now unfit for military service than formerly. The extreme northern part of Norway is inhabited to a large extent by the two peoples of the Mongolian race, the Finns and the Kvanes. The Finns are small, the men averaging about 5 feet in height. Their faces broad with prominent cheekbones. Their complexion is dark, their hair generally chestnut brown, the growth of beard scant. In the inland districts, they live as nomads on their flocks of reindeer, with which they move about from the mountains to the sea coast and back again, as the seasons require. The greater number, however, live in permanent homes near the coast, where they are engaged in fishing. In 1891, the Finnish population in Norway numbered 20,780. Of these, 2,912 spoke the Norwegian language, the rest still use their own Finnish tongue. The Bible has been translated into their language, and the government has, especially of late years, done much to Christianize and educate them. The theory that the Finns once occupied the whole of Scandinavia, and that they were gradually forced northward when the Scandinavians entered the peninsula, can no longer be maintained. They seem to have immigrated from Asia at a time when the Scandinavians already dwelt in the peninsula, and they have never occupied a territory much larger than at the present time. The Kvanes are a large and well-built people. Like the Finns, they are found mostly in the two northern provinces, Tromsø and Finnmarken. Norway has, at different times, received immigrants from this Finno-Ugrian race. In the 13th century, some Permians came from northern Russia into the Tromsø province, but no trace of them can be found at the present time. More important was the immigration from Finland about 1600 to the forest regions along the eastern borders of Norway. Most of the immigrants settled in Sweden, but some located on the Norwegian side of the border, and the tract has since been known as the Finn Forest. They have now been so far assimilated that only a few individuals speak the Finnish language. The most important emigration from Finland to the northern provinces of Norway took place in the 18th century. It began during the Great Northern War, 1700 to 1720, when the Finns who lived in what was then Swedish territory were so sorely harassed by the Russian soldiery that many fled from their homes. The movement increased about the middle of the 19th century, but of late years it has ceased. End of chapter 6. Chapter 7 of History of the Norwegian People, Volume 1 by Knut Gjerset. Chapter 7, The Dawn of Historic Norway. Many invaluable finds of relics of antiquity have helped to throw light on the life and customs of the Scandinavian peoples in prehistoric ages. But valuable as this evidence is, it is circumstantial and indirect. No account was left by the people themselves of their life and institutions, or of the vicissitudes and struggles through which they passed. But about 800 AD, the silence of the past is broken by the skalds, who in their songs celebrate the exploits and great qualities of chieftains and rulers, and recount many important historic events. As an historical source, the skaldic songs are of the highest value. The skalds were, as a rule, members of the king's herd, or court, and followed him on his military expeditions. They were not only contemporary with the events which they describe, but were often eyewitnesses of, or even partakers in them. Another important and generally quite reliable source for the early history of Scandinavia are the accounts given of the Norsemen by early writers in other European countries. In many lands, old chroniclers have recorded, often with glowing colors but usually with solemn brevity, the unwelcome visits of the bold warriors of the North. Fragmentary and often one-sided as such accounts necessarily are, they furnish many valuable data regarding the life and doings of the Vikings in foreign lands. It was left, however, for the saga writers to give comprehensive and detailed accounts of the persons and events during the Viking Age. The sagas are narratives written in excellent prose style, and in many instances they are based on the songs of the skalds as a source. Though very similar in form and style, they differ widely in contents and character. Some resemble more closely the historical novel, others are still more imaginative productions dealing with mythological and heroic elements, while some are history in a strict sense, where the author pursues his narrative with critical method, and with strict regard for truth and accuracy. With consummate skill, the writer pictures the character and psychological traits of the persons in the narrative. Life and customs, thoughts, sentiments, social and political institutions, are described with never-erring insight, and with nicely measured regard for detail and coloring. The events are narrated with simple straightforwardness, but the circumstances and motives giving rise to them, and the long train of results following them, often lend the story dramatic features cast in a calm, somber, epic mold. The sagas which deal with fabulous or mythological heroes and traditions are held by many to be a later growth in saga literature. Such are the Volsungssaga, the Hrolfssaga, the Ragnar Lodbrok-saga, the Frithjof-saga, and others. The earlier sagas were written about distinguished men and their families, for the purpose of recounting their great achievements, and especially for the sake of perpetuating the knowledge of the family relationship so important in all early Germanic society. Many of these sagas furnish important historical material. Among these may be mentioned the Egil-saga, the Laxdal-saga, the Njal-saga, and the Gunnlaug-saga. Sagas were also written about the Norwegian kings, and about discoveries and colonies founded in the Western Islands. Olaf's saga Tryggvasonar, Olaf's saga Inselga, Sverri's saga, Orkneying saga, narrating the history of the Orkney Islands, Landnamabok, dealing with the colonization of Iceland, Sigmund Brestinsson saga, containing the early history of the Faroe Islands, and the saga of Erik the Red, or Thorfinn Karlsevne's saga, found in the Hauksbok, which tells about the discovery of America by the Norsemen, are among these. Some authors undertook more ambitious works, and wrote in connected narrative the whole history of Norway from about 850 to their own time. Of such works may be mentioned Historia de Antiquate Regnum Norwegiansum, written in Latin by the monk Theodric, Theodricus Monachus, and Historia Norwegiae, also in Latin by an unknown author. Agrip af Noregs, Konungasogum, Morkinskinna, Fagerskinna, and above all Snorre Sturluson's masterly work, Heimskringla. Snorre was an historian of high rank. He is a writer of rare ability and a scholar with historical and critical method. Most of the sagas were written in Iceland during the 12th and 13th centuries. Some were written in Norway, partly by Icelanders and partly also by native sagamen. As the sagas do not always describe contemporary events, but often deal with periods long past, it need cause no wonder that in these narratives the real historic occurrences are often hidden by a growth of fiction which only the most careful critical analysis can pare away. Where the saga writers describe the institutions, life, and customs of their own time, they generally give a most vivid and realistic picture, but in the finer details of historic events, it is often difficult to separate fact from fiction, a weakness common to all early historians. The new period of development, which began in the 8th century, is heralded by many important changes which show that cultural life in the north had begun a new and more independent growth. The language, which hitherto had been but slightly differentiated from the Germanic tongue, now became a distinct Scandinavian dialect. The runic alphabet of 24 letters, common to all Germanic peoples, was replaced in the north by the younger runic alphabet of 16 characters, about 850. This system is developed from the older runic alphabet, and has been used exclusively in the Scandinavian countries. At this time also began the Viking expeditions, which became of such far-reaching importance to the development of the north. The word Viking means warrior, not, as hitherto generally held, a dweller by a vik or bay. The word was applied earlier also to other Germanic peoples. It is found in the Old English poem Vidsith, and in southern Germany it occurs as a man's given name. From now on, it was used to designate the bold Scandinavian sea rovers. Their journeys across the sea into foreign lands, which hitherto had occurred rather sporadically, now took more definite shape. The Scandinavian peoples began a great forward movement eastward, southward, and westward, which can only be regarded as a continuation of the Great Migrations. Just when the movement started cannot be definitely stated, neither is it possible to determine with accuracy when it terminated, but it is certain that it began prior to 800, and that about 1050 it had spent its force. This period, called by archaeologists the Younger Iron Age, is known in history as the Viking Age. Shipbuilding had reached a high stage of development in the north even prior to this era. The Norsemen had well-constructed seagoing vessels, fitted out with mast and sail. Their home environment pointed to the sea as the surest and quickest road to wealth and conquest. Hitherto it had been regarded as a barrier behind which the peoples could dwell secure, and hamlets and monasteries nestled in profound quiet among the unprotected shores. The Norsemen made it a highway from island to island and from coast to coast. When their well-equipped fleets, tired of coasting along their own shores, turned their sharp prows westward in search of conquest and adventure, it marked not only the beginning of the Viking Age, but the dawn of ocean navigation, and the development of naval warfare, which was gradually to produce the formidable navies and the interoceanic commerce of modern times. End of chapter 7. Chapter 8 of History of the Norwegian People, Volume 1, by Knut Gjerset. Chapter 8, The Early Viking Expeditions. The Viking expeditions began about 790. The Anglo-Saxon Chronicle mentions the Vikings even earlier. For the year 787, it records the following. In this year, King Breotic married King Offa's daughter, Eadberg, and in his days came the first three ships of the Northmen from Hirothalinda. These were the first Danish ships which visited the land of the Anglian people. King Breothric ruled from 787 till 800. The chronicle does not say that the ships came in 787, but in his day. In 793 the Vikings plundered the monastery of Lindisfarne. They came from the north, that is, from Norway, or the islands north of Scotland. The next year they appeared in Northumbria, where they attacked the monastery of Jarrow, near the mouth of the Tyne, but this time they were driven away. We are also told that in 795 a fleet numbering more than 100 ships came to South Wales, but they were driven off by King Maredudd. The spirited resistance which they met with may have been the reason why no further attempts were made against England for many years. Instead, they turned their attention to Ireland, and to the islands along the coast, which proved to be an easier prey. In 795, the Norwegian Vikings appeared on the coast of Leinster, where they seized the island of Rotru, which they called Lambay, a name which it still bears. 2 years later, they took the island Innispadrig, which they gave the Norwegian name Holmpatrick. The home of these Vikings is called Hirotha, by the Irish annalists, which is no doubt a corruption form of Hirothaland, Hordaland, on the southwest coast of Norway. From year to year, the ravages were renewed. The shrine of St. Columba on the island of Iona was plundered in 802 and again in 806. The treasures were carried away, and many of the monks were slain. The survivors fled to Ireland, bringing with them the bones of the saint. Lindisfarne and Iona were still regarded as the greatest sanctuaries in the Western Christian Church, and the wanton destruction of these holy places filled the minds of the Christian nations of Western Europe with an almost superstitious fear of this hitherto unknown enemy. These early expeditions to the British Isles, which evidently came from the west coast of Norway, were undertaken for the sole purpose of plunder. The Shetland and Orkney Islands served as vantage points from which the marauders would sweep down on the unprotected coasts, plunder some town or monastery, and depart with their booty as suddenly as they came. Seldom did the terror-stricken inhabitants offer any effective resistance. End of chapter 8. Chapter 9 of History of the Norwegian People, Volume 1 by Knut Gjerset. Chapter 9. The Vikings in Ireland and in the Islands. The success which the Vikings met with encouraged them to renewed attempts. Year by year their fleets grew larger, and their attacks soon changed from mere piratic forays to well-organized expeditions aiming at conquest and colonization. The year after the sack of Iona, they landed on the west coast of Ireland and destroyed the monastery of Inishmurray. From 812 till 814, they appeared far inland in Munster, Ulster, and Connacht, defeating the bands of the Irish kings and plundering churches and monasteries. Their fleets soon swarmed around all the coasts of Ireland. In 826, they met the first permanent settlement in the county of Meath, and during the next decade they extended their marauding expeditions almost to the heart of the country. In 836, two fleets, numbering in all about 60 ships, sailed up the rivers Liffey and Boyne. Torgils or Turgis, the great sea king, was the leader. He became king of all the Norsemen in Ireland, and began a systematic conquest of the country. He built fortified strongholds, both inland and along the coasts, and founded the city of Dublin, which soon became the center and seat of government of the Norwegian colonies in the island. Limerick, a second Norwegian city, was founded on the Shannon River in the north of Ireland, where Viking colonies were springing up. Turgis evidently aimed at destroying Christianity in Ireland. Monasteries were destroyed, and churches were plundered and turned into heathen temples. For a while it looked as if the Asa faith would triumph over the cross, but in 845 the Viking king fell by chance into the hands of Maelsechlainn, High King of Erin, who put him to death. He was long remembered as the founder of the Viking dominion in Ireland. On these westward expeditions, the Vikings had discovered the Faroe Islands, the Orkneys, and the Shetland Islands prior to the year 800. These barren and inhospitable island groups had at the time a few Celtic inhabitants, but the Norsemen took full possession of them and planted settlements there, and the population soon became wholly Norwegian. The Hebrides, too, were settled. From 820 to 830, the Vikings came in such numbers that the islands were called by Irish annalists Innsgall, i.e., the Islands of the Strangers. The new settlers accepted the Christian faith and culture of the native Celtic population in the Hebrides, but Norwegian customs and mode of life prevailed. The original inhabitants gradually adopted the ways of the conquerors, and Norwegian social organization became general throughout the islands. End of chapter 9. Chapter 10 of History of the Norwegian People, Volume 1 by Knut Gjerset. Chapter 10. The Vikings in France and Spain. In 810 to 820, the Vikings began to visit the island of Nurmutur, near the mouth of the Loire, on the west coast of France. That they came from Ireland, where the Norwegian Vikings were gathering in great numbers, seems the more certain, because the northern coasts of France were not disturbed at this time. In 843, a fleet of 67 ships came to the Loire directly from Norway, and a permanent colony was established on Nordmutter. They called themselves Vestfoldingi, i.e. men from Vestfold, in southern Norway. From this base of operations they ascended the Loire, and captured and sacked the city of Nantes. Returning to Nordmutter, with their booty, they made another expedition up the Garonne River in 844, under their leader Askir, attacking the cities of Toulouse, Bordeaux, Nantes, and Tours. They also ascended the Adour, in Gascogne, as far as to Tarbes, but lost many men in battles with the mountaineers. Leaving southern France for a time, they made an attack on the coast of Spain. After an unsuccessful siege of Lisbon, they followed the coast to Cadiz, plundered the city, and ascended the Guadalquivir to Sevilla, in Andalusia. They besieged the city and captured the suburbs, but they were unable to take the city itself. In Spain they fought many battles with the Saracens, whose prowess they soon learned to respect. From their settlements in the Loire, the Norsemen made repeated expeditions into southern France. In 877, they took permanent possession of a region along the coast, and founded a colony which long maintained its independent existence. The colonies on the Loire acknowledged the supremacy of the Norwegian kings of Dublin, who were regarded as overlords of all the Norwegian colonies in the west. In 859, a new Viking expedition was fitted out in western France, for a voyage to Spain and the Mediterranean Sea, possibly also for the purpose of attacking Rome itself. The wealth and glory of the Eternal City must have presented special attractions to these bands of professional warriors, who sought in hazardous adventure both honor and pastime. Danish Vikings seem to have joined with the Norwegians from the Loire colonies in the enterprise, as the renowned Hasting or Hastein, the son of Atle Jarl in Fjallafylke, Sinfjord, in western Norway, and Ivar Boneless, son of the famous Danish chieftain Ragnar Lodbrok, were the leaders of the expedition. Hasting is well known in the annals of western Europe, which describe him as the incarnation of all that was fierce and terrible in Viking character. Ivar, who later became the leader of the great Viking army which invaded England in 866, was one of the most renowned of Ragnar Lodbrok's sons. The fleet sailed around Spain to the mouth of the Rhone River, in southern France, where they seized and fortified the island of Camargue. From here they made an attack on the coast of Italy, where they captured the city of Luna, mistaking it for Rome. Through these expeditions, the Norsemen came into contact with the Saracens in Spain, and communications were established between Dublin and southern Europe. In 844, the Norwegian king in Dublin sent an embassy to Emir Abderrahman II of Spain, who in return sent the poet Al-Ghazal as special envoy to the king of the pagans in Ireland. Al-Ghazal left an account of his mission, in which he speaks of the many conversations he had with the queen, whom he praises highly for her beauty and courtly manners. When he expressed anxiety lest their conversations should arouse the king's jealousy, the queen replied, "It is not customary with us to be jealous. Our women stay with their husbands only as long as they please, and leave them whenever they choose." The Vikings brought a large number of Moors as prisoners to Erin, says the chronicle. These are the blue men of Erin. Long indeed did these blue men remain in Erin. Commercial relations were also established between Spain and the Norwegian colonies in Ireland, and merchants sailed from Dublin to Spain to buy silk, leather, and costly cloth from the Arabs. The geographical location of the Scandinavian countries determined, very largely, the routes taken by the Viking bands from each, as well as the localities to which their operations were chiefly confined. Those coming from Norway followed, as a rule, a northerly route, leading to Ireland, Scotland, and the islands in the Northern Ocean. From Ireland, this route led farther to the west coast of France, to Spain, and the coasts of the Mediterranean Sea, and there can be little doubt that the hosts who directed their warlike activities to these regions were in the main Norwegians, led by Norwegian chieftains. The Danish Vikings usually followed a more southerly route, leading to Friesland, Flanders, England, and the north coast of France. That Danish Vikings in early centuries took part in the Great Migrations is possible. The expedition of Trochilaicus, Hygelac, into the Rhine country in 515 has already been mentioned, but their powerful kinsmen, the Saxons, dwelling to the south of them, seem to have been an effective barrier against extensive operations in that direction, and no general movement is noticed before the beginning of the Viking Age. During the reign of Charlemagne, Viking fleets were seen to hover around the northern shores of the empire, but the energetic emperor, who discerned the danger, established military posts to guard the coasts. He even ordered fleets to be built, but the order was not carried out. His aggressive policy on the southern borders of Denmark aroused, however, the hostility of the Danes, and King Siegfried gave aid and shelter to those who had rebelled against Charles. In 810, a Danish fleet of 200 ships ravaged Friesland. Later, the powerful King Godfred began war against the Emperor, but he was killed by one of his own men in the midst of the campaign, 811. While Charles lived, no other general advance against the Empire was attempted, but when he died, the opportunity came. The strength of the Empire was soon lost through weak rulers and internal dissensions. Maladministration and disorder prevailed, and the Vikings were quick to seize the opportunity. The attack began in 834, when a Danish fleet sailed to the Rhine and ascended the river to the rich city of Dorstadt, which was seized and plundered. In rapid succession, new attacks were made during the years following. In 837, the Vikings also captured the island of Walcheren. These events led the emperors Louis and Pius and Lothar to grant Dorstadt, Walcheren, and neighboring districts to a Danish prince, Harald Klak, with the understanding that he should defend the coast of Friesland against the Vikings, but this only served to give them a new foothold. The Danes were soon masters of Friesland, whence they could fit out new expeditions into the wrecked empire. The Frankish kings, who were unable to meet them on the field of battle, were forced to buy peace by paying a yearly tribute, which was often made oppressively high by the victorious Viking chieftains. In 845, an expedition led by Ragnar Lodbrok captured Rouen, advanced up the Seine, and fortified themselves on some islands in the river. King Charles the Bald hastened to Paris to defend the city, but he failed to bring with him a sufficient military force, and was obliged to seek refuge in the fortified monastery of St. Denis. Most of the inhabitants fled from the city, and the Vikings plundered the suburbs and penetrated far into the neighboring districts, practically unmolested. Again, the old method of buying peace had to be resorted to. King Charles agreed to pay Ragnar 7,000 pounds of silver on condition that he should leave France, and that he should not again attack the country. Ragnar returned to Denmark, it seems, but new hosts soon appeared under new leaders. Following the large rivers, they penetrated far inland, and plundered large districts. Paris was again attacked in 857, and once more heavy taxes had to be levied to buy off the enemy. The leader of the Viking host now operating on the Seine was Bjorn Ironside, a son of Ragnar Lodbrok, whom King Charles the Bald sought in vain to drive from his fortified camp on the island of Oisil, above Rouen. Piratic expeditions were constantly undertaken into the neighboring country, and in 861 Paris was again sacked. King Charles now offered the Norsemen on the Somme River 3,000 pounds of silver to attack the Viking camp on Oisil, and the attack was also made, but the two Viking hosts soon came to an understanding, we are told, and left France in the spring of 862. The Viking inroads in France continued. In 885 a large army assembled on the Seine and laid siege to Paris, but they were finally persuaded to withdraw upon receiving a tribute of 700 pounds of silver. They were, however, allowed to advance and plunder the rich districts of Burgundy. The great Viking army met with no real check till it was finally defeated by the German Emperor Arnulf near Louvain in 891. End of chapter 10. Chapter 11 of History of the Norwegian People, Volume 1, by Knut Gjerset. Chapter 11, The Vikings in England. After their first visits to the coast of England, an interval of some 40 years passed, during which the Vikings made no further attempts to gain a foothold there. They pressed with vigor their conquests in Ireland and France, and England was given a respite, during which ample preparation might have been made to meet the coming storm. But internal strife between petty kingdoms, and ceaseless feuds among princes and other men of quality, gradually wore down the strength of the Anglo-Saxons, and left them weak and disorganized. One thing had been achieved, however, in these 40 years, which became of far-reaching importance in the coming struggle. King Egbert of Wessex succeeded in uniting all the Anglo-Saxon kingdoms in 827, and could now rule as King of the English. But of more immediate importance than this weak union, and Egbert's precarious supremacy, was the fact that the Kingdom of Wessex now became the center of English national life and development, and that a dynasty of kings of superior ability ascended the throne, and made this small kingdom a tower of strength which ultimately broke the force of the coming invasion. In 834, the Vikings began their attack on England in earnest by ravaging the island of Sheppey at the mouth of the Thames. In 836 they returned to the coast of Wessex with 35 ships, and near Charmouth in Dorsetshire, where King Egbert resided, a bloody battle was fought in which the Vikings were victorious. It is noteworthy that this attack occurred almost simultaneously with the plundering of Dorstadt, and the expeditions against the Frankish kingdom. It can scarcely be doubted that it was the same armed host which operated on both sides of the English Channel, and that the Vikings who now appeared in England were Danes. In 838 a great fleet came to the land of the West Welsh, made an alliance with them, and attacked Wessex. King Egbert marched against the Allies, and defeated them with great slaughter at Hengestestun, near Plymouth, but this was his last exploit. He died the following year, and was succeeded by his son Ethelwulf, a pious and conscientious but weak man, who was unable to cope successfully with the invaders. After Egbert's death, the Vikings began more extensive operations in England. In 840 they made two successful raids on the coast of Wessex, and in the year following they entered the Wash, defeated and slew the elder man of Lindesey, and plundered his land. They then turned south to ravage the coasts of East Anglia and Kent. London and Rochester were attacked in 842 by a large fleet, and the following summer King Ethelwulf was defeated in the Second Battle of Charmouth in Wessex. Northumbria, too, was attacked in 844, and King Redwulf was slain by the invaders. Norwegian Vikings, too, seem to have taken part in these raids on the English coasts. But as a rule, no distinction between Norwegians and Danes is made in the early English annals, and it is left for us to draw what conclusions we may from the general direction of the attacks. In 846, a Viking band attempted to land on the coast of Somersetshire, but they were defeated by Bishop Aelstan and two ealdormen at the mouth of the Parret. The locality of the fight makes it probable that this band, at least, were Norsemen from the coast of Ireland. The Three Fragments of Irish Annals states that in the year 851 the Norsemen attacked Devonshire, while the Danes harried Kent and Surrey. This agrees in the main with the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle, which records for the same year the fact that the ealdormen Ciaran fought with heathen men in Devonshire, near Wickenborg, killed many of them, and gained the victory. These raids on the coast seem to have been mere skirmishes, preliminary to the more general advance which began in 851, when a fleet of 350 ships entered the Thames River. A force was landed, which captured Canterbury, while the fleet proceeded to London, which was stormed and plundered. The invading host began to spread over the inland districts, but King Ethelwulf and his son Ethelbald arrived with the whole military force of Wessex and defeated the Vikings in the bloody Battle of Aclea. This produced a brief lull in the invasion, but a new host appeared in 854, and taking up quarters on Sheppey Island in the Thames, they were now able for the first time to spend the winter in England. Every summer the attacks were renewed, until in 866 the great Viking army led by Ivar Boneless and Ube Urhubba, the sons of Ragnar Lodbrok, arrived and began a conquest which placed the greater part of England under Viking dominion before another decade had passed. This time the attack was directed against Northumbria, which was more torn by internal troubles than any other part of England. Wars between rival candidates for the throne had been waged there constantly for many years, and were still in progress when the Vikings arrived. They mixed merrily in the fight, and made themselves masters of the important city of York, a calamity so great that it even brought the two fighting rivals, Osbjart and Ella, to their senses. They patched up their differences, united their forces, and made an assault upon York in an attempt to recapture the city. But they were both killed, their army was cut to pieces, and Northumbria submitted to the conquerors, 867. In 868, the Viking chieftains advanced with their army to Nottingham, and wintered in Mercia. In 870, they entered East Anglia. King Edmund met them in the Battle of Hoxney, but lost both his army and his life. The story is told that he was captured, and being unwilling to pay tribute and to submit to Ivar Boneless, he was tied to a tree and shot to death with arrows. This may be true, since he was worshipped as a saint not long after his death. The Danes at York invited the Norwegian kings Ivar and Oluf of Dublin to join in the conquest of England. They accepted the invitation, harried northern England, and captured Dumbarton on the Clyde, but they soon had to return to Dublin to defend their own dominions against the Irish. In 870, a large army came from Denmark to join the conquest. It was led by Halfdan, Halfdan, Hubba, Ube, Guthrum, Guttorm or Gorm, and many other kings and jarls. The next year they advanced through Mercia to attack Wessex, and pitched their camp at Reading, which they took care to fortify. A fierce campaign was now fought. The men of Wessex, led by King Ethelred and his younger brother Alfred, advanced to attack them, and a series of sharp engagements were fought which forced the Danes to retire to their fortified camp at Reading. An attempt to take the camp by assault proved unsuccessful, and the English were driven back with great slaughter. The Danes now emerged from their camp, but were again met by Ethelred and Alfred on the hills of Æsixdun, Ashdown, where they were defeated, after a desperate battle in which the young Alfred especially distinguished himself. The Danes lost one of their kings, Bægskeg, five jarls and many thousand men. The remaining king, Halfdan, shut himself up in the camp at Reading with the remnant of his army to await reinforcements. In 2 weeks he was again able to take the field, fighting a successful engagement at Basing, and the Battle of Bedwin soon followed, in which the Danes were again victorious. King Ethelred died shortly after from wounds received in the battle, as it seems, and Alfred the Great succeeded to the throne of Wessex. As he had but a small army and no navy, he was forced to buy peace from the victorious Vikings. They received a tribute and withdrew from Wessex, and the kingdom was left unmolested for about 4 years. During this time, Alfred began to reorganize a navy, which in future contests was to develop strength and efficiency in the hard school of sharp naval warfare with the powerful Viking admirals, who regarded the sea as their own undisputed domain. The Viking army, after leaving London and subjugating Mercia, was divided into two parts, one under King Halfdan and the other under Guthrum, Oskytil, and Almond. Halfdan raided Bernicia, Strathclyde, and parts of Scotland, and settled permanently at York in 875. The other part of the army camped in Mercia. All England was now in the hands of the invaders, save the kingdom of Wessex, south of the Thames. During the 80 or 90 years which had passed since the first Viking bands visited the shores of England, great changes had taken place both in the extent and character of their operations in foreign countries. The early piratic attacks changed in time into well-planned expeditions, undertaken by large fleets and armies bent on permanent conquest. Wars were waged, which were often attended by wanton destruction of life and property, but the Vikings now fought for the purpose of gaining full dominion over territory in which they wished to live and rule. They were no longer a mere destructive force. The conquest once accomplished, they settled down to till the soil, to build cities, and to develop the country. In the various pursuits of peace, they often showed an energy, a practical insight, and a talent for organization not exhibited by the native inhabitants. In many fields, they exerted a stimulating influence which made future progress possible. During the winter, which King Halfdan spent in London after retiring from Wessex, he minted coins bearing sometimes his own name, sometimes that of the city. The designs were later used on English coins struck by Alfred the Great, and by Ceolwulf, King of Mercia. In 875, Halfdan took up his permanent abode in York. The Anglo-Saxon Chronicle states that he portioned out the lands of Northumbria, and that his followers henceforth continued to plough and to till them. Every Dane received his allotment of land, while the original inhabitants continued to exist as a dependent class. According to Viking custom, York was strongly fortified, and became again the great city which it had been in the days of Roman dominion in Britain. This custom of walling in the cities and of building fortified strongholds, which was so important, both in warfare and for the development of cities, was first introduced into England by the Vikings. The coining of money was also carried on here, and the crude copper coins heretofore used were soon replaced by coins of silver. Deira, the southern part of Northumbria, was organized into the Danish kingdom of York, while Bernicia, the northern part, was tributary to the kings of York, but formed no integral part of their kingdom. End of chapter 11. Chapter 12 of History of the Norwegian People, Volume 1, by Knut Gjerset. Chapter 12, Alfred the Great and the Vikings. After Alfred had entered into an agreement with the Vikings, Wessex enjoyed peace for some years, but in 875 the Viking host was again collected for a new attack on the kingdom. The invaders marched across Wessex to Wareham, on the south coast, where they constructed a fortified camp. Alfred met them here with a large force, and the two armies lay watching each other for some time. The Danes finally agreed to depart if they received a tribute, and a treaty was concluded, but a part of their force escaped from Wareham and marched to Exeter, which they seized and fortified. Alfred followed close on their heels and besieged the town. The remainder of the force at Wareham soon evacuated their camp and put to sea to join their besieged companions. But their fleet was destroyed in a storm, and the detachment at Exeter, being hard-pressed by Alfred, promised to leave Wessex. Alfred allowed them to depart, and they advanced into Mercia, where they forced King Ceolwulf to give them a large part of his kingdom. This land was divided among many jarls, the five most important divisions being Stamford, Lincoln, Derby, Nottingham, and Leicester, which were later known as the Five Boroughs. All the divisions formed together a loose confederacy embracing the eastern half of Mercia. The great Viking army was still kept united under the command of King Guthrum. Aided by other forces operating in the Irish Sea, they again advanced to attack Wessex. An auxiliary squadron was led by Hubba, Ube, a brother of Halfdan and Ivar Boneless, and Guthrum began his campaign in the middle of January 878. The unexpected attack at this season of the year caused the greatest panic. Many fled the country without thinking of resistance, and King Alfred with his military household was forced to take refuge on the island of Athelney, in the Parrot River in Somerset. During the remaining months of the winter of 878, the Vikings were masters of all Wessex, but when spring came, the tide began to turn. Hubba fell in Devonshire, in an attack on the English stronghold Sinuit, and his force was cut to pieces. Shortly after Easter, Alfred left Athelney, gathered all forces possible, and attacked the Danish army at Ethandune, gaining a complete victory. Guthrum submitted and received baptism with 29 other leaders. The treaty concluded received its name from the royal manor of Wedmore, where the baptismal feast was celebrated. According to its stipulations, a region including Northumbria, East Anglia, and all central England east of a line stretching from the mouth of the Thames River, along the River Lee to Bedford, along the Ouse to Watling Street, and along Watling Street to Chester was ceded to the Vikings. This region was henceforth known as the Danelag, Danelaw. Guthrum seems to have carried out quite faithfully the agreement entered into. He left Wessex and took possession of East Anglia and Essex, where he founded a kingdom similar to that established in York by King Halfdan. He took part in Viking expeditions to France, and even aided Danish Vikings operating on the coast of England. But he never again attacked Wessex. He died in 890. After the Treaty of Wedmore, in 878, Alfred's kingdom enjoyed comparative peace until 892, when the Great Army undertook a new invasion of England. This permanently organized host of Danish Vikings had been operating in Brabant and Flanders, where it had been defeated by Emperor Arnulf in 891. The names of the leaders of the Great Army are not mentioned, but it was joined by a smaller detachment of 80 ships, evidently coming from the Norwegian colonies on the west coast of France, led by the famous Viking chieftain Hasting. The war lasted for 3 years, but the Vikings could gain no permanent advantage over Alfred's well-organized armies. Alfred captured their fleet and besieged them closely in their camps. Finally, worn out by fruitless fighting, the Great Army broke up and joined their countrymen in East Anglia and Northumbria, but a detachment sailed across the sea to the Shine. These must have been the Norsemen under Hasting, with whom Alfred seems to have concluded a treaty of peace. Alfred had broken up the great organized host of invasion, and had created an efficient fleet which was able to cope successfully with Viking detachments along the coast. Hasting left England in 897, and the peace was not again disturbed during the remaining 4 years of Alfred's reign. King Halfdan of York had ruled his kingdom only 1 year, 876 to 877, when he was expelled by his own people. His successor, Gudrid, died in 894, and Canute, who was then placed on the throne, had to share his authority with the Norwegian Jarl Sigurd, who had gained great power in northern Scotland. This shows that there were Norsemen, as well as Danes, in the Viking kingdom at York, an assumption which is borne out by the many names of Norwegian origin found in Northumbria. Snorre Sturluson says in the Heimskringla that Northumbria was mostly settled by Norsemen after the sons of Ludbrok had conquered the land. Norwegians and Danes must often have fought side by side, and the conquest once completed, a period of immigration followed, in which men and women from both countries flocked across the sea to settle in the new and inviting land which they had won. During the first stages of the struggle, the invading armies were almost exclusively Danish, but the Norwegian element must have grown rapidly in importance, especially in the north, and their leaders soon gained the ascendancy in Northumbria. End of chapter 12. Chapter 13 of History of the Norwegian People, Volume 1 by Knut Gjerset. Chapter 13. Names applied to the Vikings. Long before the beginning of the Viking Age, the Gautar, Swedes, and Danes seem to have been quite well known as distinct peoples, occupying clearly defined regions of the Scandinavian North. The names are used frequently, both by the early Old English authors and by Latin writers of the early centuries of the Christian era. But Norway, as a term applied to the western half of the Scandinavian peninsula, and Norsemen, or Norwegians, as a name used to designate all the inhabitants of this region, are terms which do not occur till in the Viking period. The notice in the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle for the year 787, already mentioned elsewhere, uses the name Northmanna. On his dagum common three shippu Northmanna of Herethalande. King Alfred uses the name Northman in his writings, 880-900. And Uthore, Otar, the Norwegian explorer, who stayed at his court, uses the names Northmannaland and Norweg for the whole of Norway. The Irish monk Dechwil, who wrote in 825, states that the Irish monks on the Faroe Islands had to flee because of the Latronum Normannorum. It seems, then, that these names must have been quite commonly used about 800. Norway, Norger, Norveger, Norge, means the northern way, and Norsemen, men from the north. These names seem first to have been applied.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.